Hello and welcome to my new video. This time I want to give you an overview about my approaches of modeling natural objects. We'll do script-based modeling, which means it is relatively easy to model things obeying to a certain rule, but difficult to model completely irregular things. For me, it was exciting to discover the rules of natural structures, so script-based modeling was precisely the right thing. By the way, in this video I will only give you a very rough outline. All structures introduced here will be detailed in individual videos in this playlist. Some of them are already in place, some of them are not ready yet. So, what are structures obeying to a certain rule? Snail shells are good examples. They refer to simple logarithmic spirals. Using the right set of formulas, it is pretty easy to make these spheres follow the respective path, and when we fuse and enlarge these spheres, we end up with a typical snail shell. Another set of highly regular structures is exemplified by this little plantlet. How can we make such a leaf arrangement? Very easily, you simply have to rotate subsequent leaves by the golden angle, 137.5 degrees. This is a widespread principle in the plant kingdom, which can also be observed in leaf arrangements along some branches. On the next level, there are other structures like this erythrocyte, which are highly regular as well, but demand a certain amount of randomness. This erythrocyte basically only is a round platelet with a thickened rim. It looks more natural, however, if we randomly select two positions labeled by green spheres in the upper left insert set, decrease the y coordinate of elements adjacent to one of these, and increase the y coordinate of elements adjacent to the other one. In contrast to the erythrocyte, this is a very random structure. Guess where we can use it in biology? We need such blobs when visualizing certain cells, like leukocytes, or certain enveloped viruses, like the influenza or AIDS virus. It is easy to create by simply randomly distributing a number of spheres in a spherical way, and then making the spheres increase in size and fuse. Elements can be distributed in this spherical way, as just shown, or in a Cartesian way, as shown here. Such a distribution often can be used as the basis for arrangements, sometimes combined with a certain degree of randomness. To the left, there is a relatively regular tissue of plant cells with a low amount of randomness. The arrangement of background viruses to the right has been done with a high degree of randomness. These were the simple things. Now let's talk about some more complex structures. What do I mean when I am saying complexity? Complexity arises primarily when elements interact with each other. Here I am presenting two examples where interactions affect position and orientation of elements. Chloroplasts of plant cells, to the left, are aligned along plant cell walls, and envelope proteins of this influenza virus, to the right, are located within this envelope, of course, and are oriented perpendicular to the virus surface. In both cases, the shape of the larger structure determines position and orientation of the small elements, and I will show in respective videos how to do this. Another example, where elements interact with each other, affecting each other's position, is such a worm. It is best modeled using some kind of random walk, starting with the element at the bottom, where you allow a certain amount of randomness for finding the position of each new element. Such random walks can be used for building up ramified structures as well. To the left, I used only bifurcated elements, which were decreased in size and rotated by 90 degrees in subsequent turns. The ends of each element serve as starting points for new elements in the subsequent turn. And what about the branches to the right? Here I used two different kinds of elements, one branched one and one non-branched one. Again, the end point of each element serves as starting point for the subsequent turn, but this time elements are rotated to a certain random degree and not scaled. The probability for selecting a branched or non-branched element can be changed and has a strong impact on the final structure. Did you notice that these structures have a certain degree of fractal character? I will talk about fractal structures in later videos in more detail, but I think that the ability to easily generate such structures is one of the strong points of script-based modeling. Apart from the random walk using branched or unbranched elements, there are other ways to generate branch structures. In respective videos, I will show you how to model these branch plant shoot systems and these root systems. By the way, branching variability below ground is comparable to above ground, we just don't notice it most of the times. While modeling branch structures is pretty straightforward with my approach, planar structures are much harder to do. After many tries, I had some success, however, as documented by this tomato leaf, but this is much more difficult than the root systems shown before. Interactions between elements may affect other properties than positional orientation. In this case, elements are affecting each other's shape. In a plant tissue, cells are pushing against each other, resulting in deformations of their usual roundish shape. When using metaballs for modeling, this negative effect of adjacent cells can be simulated, resulting in almost perfect plant tissues. However, I have to admit that this structure is very sensitive to parameters used in simulating this interplay. It proved pretty difficult to find solutions with both small intercellular spaces and intact cell walls separating individual cells.
I will skip here interactions between elements affecting element color, resulting in pattern formation. Basically, it is also possible to simulate such interactions by script-based modeling, but I never found an interesting application for this case. The last topic I shortly want to address here is data visualization. In this case here, it's the steric data of small molecules produced, example given by programs like Avogadro, which can then be displayed in various formats. In the case of such small molecule data, it can be extracted by hand and copied into Porphyry scripts. When we work with larger molecules, like this enzyme here and its substrate, this is no longer possible and we have to use computer programs to transform data from database output into ray tracing script files. I have been using Perl for this task, while nowadays most people will certainly use Python. Data visualization, however, is not limited to steric position data. These are transcriptome data from Arabidopsis thaliana, which I have arranged along a leaf, flower, root, and common axis. And last not least, these are genomic data from various organisms, which I have arranged in the form of spheres. Sphere size corresponds to genome size and the ratio of mainland to sea on these planets to gene density.
With this last application, I want to finish this video, and I will also use these genomic planets to finish my series of videos in this playlist. It will take some time until I have made all the still missing videos up to this end. Have a look from time to time how far I've come with this project.